Hi. In the previous lecture, we discussed the MCDC testing strategy for the decision tables. You will have noticed that we encountered the same strategy when discussing structural testing. So, what is the relationship between structural testing and model-based testing using decision tables? How does, for example, branch coverage compare to the all explicit variance strategy for a decision table? The most important difference is that in structural testing, the code guides the creation of test cases. The code leads to a control flow graph, shown here in a slide from our lecture on structural testing, and its branches must be covered. The scope of this is typically intra-procedural. The branches within each method must be covered, and then we're good. But interactions between methods are not specifically targeted. Model-based testing using decision tables takes a different perspective. It looks at the model, which can be obtained from requirements to see how decisions are taken. The test strategies then ensure that the essential decision logic is indeed exercised. This decision logic may be actually implemented in branches, for example, using nested if-then-else statements. In that case, a test suite derived from a decision table will also do a good job at achieving high branch coverage. However, the decision logic may also be implemented differently. For example, different subclasses can implement different variants, and the decision logic can be implemented via polymorphic methods, common in object-oriented languages that offer late binding using dynamic dispatch. Other ways to implement decision logic include configuration parameters, logic hidden in databases, or lookups in hash tables. Thus, decision tables are applicable in a wider context. Furthermore, as any functional testing strategy, model-based testing can detect omissions, variants or actions that are not even implemented, and hence can never be executed when using the code as a starting point for the tests. Lastly, models can be understandable to domain experts. This means that these domain experts can use their domain knowledge to decide which test cases are most important, offering an additional perspective on which test cases to create. The tables we have discussed so far have Boolean conditions only. Cells in the table carry either true or false as values. Decision tables can be easily generalized to non-Boolean values as well. For example, mobile phone subscriptions may come with data limits, as shown here. Possible values are no data, represented as a zero, a maximum of 8 gigabytes per month, an 8, or unlimited, symbolized with the infinity symbol here. The table here shows 6 columns only. With 2 Boolean and 1 tree-valued column, in total, there are 2 times 2 times 3 is 12 possible columns. The implicit meaning here is that unspecified columns, such as international subscriptions without data, represent invalid combinations. The various testing strategies discussed all can be generalized to conditions with multiple values. Even MCDC can be generalized to such conditions, insisting that every condition gets every value, each condition determines the outcome individually, and all possible outcomes are targeted. Non-Boolean values in decision tables can be useful in small decision tables. However, even 3 conditions with 4 possible values already result in 4 times 4 times 4 is 64 variants. Then, working with decision tables quickly becomes difficult due to the combinatorial explosion of possibilities. In such a setting, alternative strategies such as pairwise combinatorial testing will offer better scalability. Lastly, let us look at some general guidelines for when you are designing a decision table. First, keep the conditions independent. It should be possible to evaluate the conditions in any order. If the order does matter, or if the past history of events is relevant for the decision, A state machine may be a better model to use instead of a decision table. Second, keep the number of explicit variants low by using don't care DC values where possible. This helps to keep the decision table easy to understand and suitable as a means of communication between domain experts, developers, and testers. Third, variants with don't care values should preferably not overlap. If variants do overlap, their actions should be the same, as in our mobile plan example. Fourth, if the set of variants is incomplete, for example, it doesn't cover all 2 to the power of n possible variants for n conditions, add missing variants or a default column. The logic formula for the remaining variants is the negation of the disjunction of all these explicit variants. Fifth, if you see many mutually exclusive conditions, which can never be true all at the same time, you are probably encoding a non-Boolean decision into multiple conditions. Try to use a non-Boolean values instead. Finally, if you see that most conditions are non-Boolean, consider using a different combinatorial testing technique, such as pairwise testing, to avoid the combinatorial explosion problem. To conclude, let me summarize the key points we covered on decision tables. Decision tables concisely model possibly complex decision logic into an easy-to-understand visual representation. You can use them to better understand the application domain, or you can use them to describe what is going on in your code base. Once you have a decision table, you can use various test case derivation strategies. Of these, modified condition/decision coverage, MCDC, strikes a good balance between keeping the test suite manageable in size, and 2, exercising all the essential decision logic. In the exercises, you can create your own decision tables, some small, some large, and experiment with implementing them in Java and JUnit, or your own favorite programming language. Enjoy!